Hello there, welcome to Market Call. Andrew Moffs is on our show today, Senior Vice President and Portfolio Manager at Vision Capital. And he will take, great to see you, he will take your calls, emails and tweets on real estate stocks, of course including REITs, publicly traded real estate entities. You can call them toll free, 1-855-326-6266, or send an email to marketcall@bnnbloomberg.ca. Andrew, before we get going, let's just check in on the broad equity markets, if that's okay. We saw the Dow down more than 700 points in early trading. What a seesaw, though. The markets rebound one day, they drop the next amid these fears over the virus.
Yeah, certainly volatile markets. You know, for us, we focus on real estate. Price of this building hasn't changed too much in the past couple of days, but the fear is out there. We know it.
That's the beauty of real estate. Okay, in some ways, yeah, it helps diversify any portfolio. Well, let's get to that. You can see we just saw the S&P 500 in danger of falling below that 3,000 mark. So obviously, world growth will take some kind of a hit here, but you think the fundamentals for North American real estate still strong?
Yeah, you know, coming into this year, we even like to think back. Let's think a year ago. Entering 2019, what did we see on the horizon? We saw troubles with Brexit. We saw a NAFTA deal that was being questioned. Trade war with China. We had a wall of worry that we had to climb. You fast forward a year, coming into this year prior to COVID-19, a lot of those had been put off the table. And when you talk about real estate, the fundamentals, of the supply and demand fundamentals and in the geographies that we invest were pretty good. We see job growth, population growth, et cetera.
So in some ways, real estate's like an iceberg. We see the top, the publicly traded entities, but it's a far bigger industry in terms of private investment.
Yeah, that's the beauty of what we do. So we invest exclusively in the publicly traded real estate market. But unlike any other sector, the private market dwarfs the public market. So a stock analyst, what can we do? We could look at the private market, see what's going on, in, as I mentioned before, the demand and supply fundamentals. Look at the transactions that are going on, the cap rates, where basically what are the first year yield that these properties are trading at, and translate that to the public market. And where we see discounts to net asset value, the private market of the public companies, the private market value of the public companies will go long. And if we see them overvalued, as a long short fund, we'll go short.
Let's put up maybe a 1 year chart for XRE, which is the REIT ETF, just using that as a benchmark. Have we seen a sell off in the REITs over the past while?
So you talked about volatility at the open, and we've seen tremendous volatility in the XREs. Today, actually, they've closed a lot of that gap.
Okay.
But it goes back to, if you think about it, this volatility has occurred in 2 weeks. We've seen, 15% swing high to low in the past month and a half. Again, think about what these companies invest in. Commercial real estate. Did those buildings change? How much of the cut to GDP globally? What does that translate to long-term leases, If you have a credit tenant for 15 years, does that really change the value of the building? Interest rates coming down, does that bring down cap rates? These are all the questions that we ask.
Remind us what a cap rate is.
So a cap rate is the inverse of a multiple. So the way commercial real estate is valued is similar to a bond. You take what's the first year NOI of that building, and you take that number, and you take the operating income of the property, and you divide the operating income by that cap rate. By the yield, and you come up with a value for the building.
So do you want a higher or a lower cap rate?
You want a lower cap rate means a higher value to the real estate, just like a lower coupon on the bond. As rates go down, there's demand and the bond is going higher.
Right, okay, and NOI, what's that again?
Net operating income. So net operating income is simply the rents, less the expenses of the building.
So remind us how the cap rate's calculated once again, so I have it straight.
Sorry, so you take the NOI divided by the value of the building is the cap rate.
So it's the yield, essentially.
Yeah.
Okay, and you reckon that there's a wall of equity and debt capital out there interested in real estate?
Absolutely. I mean, think back last year, September of last year, Blackstone announced the largest real estate private equity fund being raised, over $20 billion. I think January of last year, Brookfield Asset Management announced a $15.5 billion real estate private equity fund. And you see it across who are their clients. You look at the institutions globally, the pension funds, the endowments, all moving their allocations from fixed income and equities into alternatives. That's all flowing into alternatives that include real estate.
And of course, generally, you touch on this, low interest rates are great for real estate valuations.
They help, certainly. Absolutely. That cap rate comes down as interest rates come down. but also the ability to finance a building. So long as the credit markets are open.
Yeah.
And if you think about that today, you know, we're investing in a company in Europe that owns apartments in the Netherlands, a company called European Residential REIT. They can buy at cap rates of 3.5%, but finance at less than 1%. Mm-hmm. That's over a 2.5% spread on buildings that are growing their net operating income over time.
And a pretty stable asset class in
Absolutely.
Harbor buildings.
Yeah.
Okay, and Dutch people, I bet Dutch people pay their rent on time from what I know about them. Anyway, we're going to be back with Andrew Moffs, Senior VP and Portfolio Manager at Vision Capital. He's taking your calls, emails and tweets on real estate stocks and REITs. 1-855-326-6266. Love this one. We got Robin in Norway sending us an email. Wants to know about a company called Invesk, trades on the TSX. Writing to you from beautiful Alesund, Norway. Sorry about the pronunciation. I guess this viewer watches on the internet. I'd like to ask Andrew about Invesk. It has a high dividend, but has performed terribly. Seems like the strategy has gone wrong or gone astray. What does this company do?
So this is a healthcare REIT. Has a high concentration in the U.S. They're based in Indiana. They operate primarily either skilled nursing, Medicare reimbursed type of facilities, as well as retirement homes and medical office buildings. It is a small cap company, really strong management. However, the market has not accepted this stock. It trades at a discount to its net asset value, and it's rumored to be going through a strategic alternative process. I think a sale might be the best thing for this stock, but at the same time, it's operating in a very tough environment.
Ryan, sorry, what has been the problem with them?
So the reimbursement environment in the U.S. for healthcare has been challenged in certain states, and they have some operators that are having a difficult time navigating that demand and supply imbalance.
Getting money from government programs, basically.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, that always seems to be a problem if you invest in these healthcare businesses. Yeah, government policy or regulations. We have Stephen calling from Calgary, wants to ask about a company that Andrew's already touched on. Go ahead, Stephen.
The First Rate Show. Andrew, I just am hoping you can elaborate a little bit on European Residential REIT. I own it to diversify my apartment holdings. Do you think management can expand the NAV and turn it into a story like InterRent? Many thanks.
Thank you very much.
So I couldn't hear the caller, but I know it's about European Residential REIT.
Okay, yeah.
I did touch on this earlier, as you said. We think this is a really great company, a very good stock. It's managed by CAPREIT, Canadian Apartment REIT, the largest residential REIT here in Canada. If you think about what CAPREIT does very well, they've navigated very successfully in an environment here in Ontario where there's rent control. And similarly, in the Netherlands, there is a form of rent control. And you have to be very strong at administrative work in order to raise the rents. The reality is in that environment, which we think they can adeptly operate in, is you can get 3-4% rent growth. At the same time, they are the only listed, publicly traded company focused on this sector. So they're seeing tremendous external growth. So we have this complementary internal growth, external growth, in a country that has a very dense population and population growth. We put all that mixed together with no new supply, and we think this will be a very strong stock.
Okay. We've got Andre in Chilliwack, BC. Go ahead, please.
How are you?
I'm very good. Thanks for calling, Andre.
Oh, good. Thanks. I'm glad that you're back at the helm.
Oh,
good to see you.
Thanks.
Yes. My question, please, is on American Tower. Given the formula that the guest just used at the opening segment, would he be open to buying a half position? And where does he see the company moving forward? Thank you, Andrew. Have a good day.
So, you know, in real estate, you either invest along the real estate cycle or you look for things with a secular change.
Mm-hmm.
And in this case, American Tower has definitely benefited from a secular change. What does that mean? We all walk around with devices in our pockets that have brought the computer to our pocket. And with that, how the infrastructure behind having everyday internet at our fingertips is predicated on having companies like American Tower. So it has benefited from that big secular shift, whereas, you know, when these companies went public, people are asking, well, what's going to happen when pagers go away?
Mm-hmm.
Will people need cell towers? Well, they were wrong. At this point, you have to be making a bet on the successful rollout of 5G. And if that is successful, then you can see continued growth in this company. Otherwise, you have, this is, I think it is the largest U.S. REIT. It is very stable, and they are global, so you have to always weigh global risk in terms of this, whether it's currencies or changes in telecom in countries like India, et cetera. But it's a safe hold for any one of your viewers.
Okay. We have Robert in London. Go ahead, Robert, please.
I'd like Andrew's opinion or on Simon Property Group. I know the stock's down approximately 17% from the beginning of the year. Mm. I'm just wondering what the outlook might be once this market recovers. Thank you.
Thanks, Manu.
Simon Property Group, one of the largest U.S. REITs, preeminent mall owner, developer, owns premium outlets, as well as successful Asian business. No doubt the mall sector is very challenged. And what is difficult to handicap at this point is who is going to win on the tenant side, meaning who is going to survive, quite frankly. We at Vision have chosen not to make that bet. Mm-hmm. In fact, we've been short retail. And where we see consumer demand going is to the internet, and hence we've been long industrial warehouse. So as it relates to Simon, they have a bulletproof balance sheet. This company will survive, absolutely. Mm-hmm. They have the ability to densify some of their assets, meaning build apartments on parking lots, structures, et cetera. So we feel very good about management. However, it's going to be tough to grow net operating income over the next several years without a large investment back into properties.
Okay. We're going to be back with Andrew Moffs, Senior VP and Portfolio Manager at Vision Capital. He's taking your questions on real estate, stocks and REITs. Give him a call, 1-855-326-6266. Tammy in Calgary sent us an email, wants to know about Minto REIT. What's your opinion?
So Minto is one of our favorite apartment stocks. They own a portfolio concentrated in Ontario, as well as more so, even more so now in Quebec. We think what we like about this company is Canadian apartments in general are benefiting from huge population growth, whether it's been the massive amount of immigration that's come to this country, as well as even foreign students. And as a result, you're seeing tremendous amount of pressure on apartments. There's no new supply. At the same time, with all this demand, rents are going up 25%. Minto's benefiting from this. So we see this company growing at their net operating income at high single-digit rates. And at the same time, the implied cap rate of the company is around just under 4% cap rate. We've seen trades of the market at a 3% cap rate. So again, the lower the cap rate, the higher the value of the building. So we still think there's a lot of room for this stock to go, even though it's traded so well.
Okay, Ram in Calgary. Go ahead, please.
Could I ask about sector of U.S. industrial warehouse REITs? Mm-hmm. They are always very expensive and overpriced. Would you have any favorite company name in your mind, like Equinix or Prologis? Thank you for your thoughts, sir.
Thank you for the call. Industrial warehouse, like I said before, is one of our favorite asset classes.
Yeah.
And Prologis is a great company. That we had owned that for 4 years. At this point, we felt it definitely caught up to its net asset value and surpassed it. Today, in the space, we like Dream Industrial here in Canada. We think that's probably the cheapest industrial warehouse stock. DIR is the symbol. And we also own WPT REIT. They recently did an equity offering, the ticker WIR. We think that is a good stock to own. It's a value stock in the space. It trades at a 6% cap rate when the market is more in the 4-4.5% cap rate.
What was that last one? IRT?
WIR.
WIR. And that, what stock is that? WPT.
WPT. Yes.
Oh, but the symbol is WIR. I'm sorry.
Exactly.
Yep. Yeah. Okay. So broadly, Prologis, do you like the valuation, though? Or
I think it's an amazing company.
Yeah.
I think they will continue to grow net asset value.
Yes.
If you own it, I would hold on to it.
No problem. Prologis, the industry giant. Peter in Vancouver, go ahead, please.
Thank you for taking my call.
Pleasure.
It's good to see you back again,
Thank
Andrew.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Bob Andrews, yeah. Andrew, may I ask you about Sienna Senior Living? Thank you very much.
Sienna Senior Living?
Yeah, so Sienna operates in the healthcare sector. More than half of their earnings come from long-term care here in Ontario and in British Columbia. We think that is a great asset class, so we like the stock. If you think about that asset class here in Ontario, you have 30,000 seniors waiting to get into a long-term care facility. When I talk about demand and supply, that's a huge imbalance when there isn't a suitable funding formula here in Ontario to build more of these centers. The other half of Sienna's business is where they have just had most recent struggles, and that's really on the supply side. It's the retirement home sector. There's been pockets of too much supply here in Canada, and Sienna's navigating itself through it. We think they're great operators. We think it trades at a discount to its net asset value. It comes with a nice dividend yield while you wait, and we think it's a good stock to own.
Okay. The thumbs up for Sienna Senior Living. We've got Frank in Montreal on the line. Frank, go ahead, please.
Yeah, thank you, Andy.
Hi.
Yeah, tell me on American Hotel Income Fund there, you think sustainable the dividend, and what's your comment on? Thank you.
Thanks.
Yeah, I think you're asking the right question. I don't think their distribution is sustainable. This is a hotel REIT focused in the United States. We had vision our short hotels. We were short coming into the year. We're more cautious now with
COVID-19. Wow. You made money on that, I guess, the hotel with the virus sell-off.
Absolutely.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, I was lucky enough to be a hotel analyst back in 2002, and I've lived through SARS, I've lived through the Iraq War, I've seen Persian Gulf, I've seen many different events, Ebola. And, you know, when you talk about real estate, hotels are the one sector where the leases reset every night. And you have a cash flow mismatch here. And so I think, unfortunately, AHIP is not going to be immune from this, and we just don't think they have the right balance sheet or the right dividend coverage.
Right. Let me just check what the what is the yield? Do you know offhand? Or
it's probably 13.5%.
Right.
I guess.
And you think that they'll have to trim that in? Yeah. I'm showing actually 14.5% right now, as you say, pretty high. Excuse me, Joe in Montreal. Go ahead, please.
I want to ask your guest about Northwest Health Properties. I picked up a small position a couple of months ago, and I know that they're probably getting hit by the virus thing, but overall, I wonder if you would think it's a good place to add on to. Thank you.
Northwest Health Properties, another of these medical REITs.
Yeah. So Northwest has done a very good job of growing its business internationally. They've grown their third-party management business tremendously. I think that is very positive for the stock, whereas before there were questions about the sustainability of their distribution, their balance sheet. I think they've done a lot of good things to fix that. It's a hold at this point. You have to get comfort with operating in Brazil, Australia, the UK, et cetera. Parts of their business I think are very strong. I'm not so keen on the medical office sector here in Canada. It's more of a generic off class B office type of business, but that's not a big driver of their earnings.
Okay, we are going to take a break, I believe, but let's check in on the markets very quickly. We did see the Dow recovering slightly from its lows of the day, but now, wow, look at that, now down almost 800 points. We did see another drop in U.S. bond yields with the Treasury note, the 10-year Treasury note, remaining below 1%. May not be deflationary, but sure looks like it's disinflationary. And let's have a look at the TSX. There's the Dow. Look at that, down almost 3%. Big gains, though, for the U.S. markets on Wednesday, partly Joe Biden making such progress, seen as a middling, moderate Democratic candidate. Also signs, as the Wall Street Journal puts it, of a coordinated response to the coronavirus worldwide. TSX also losing altitude as well. Wasn't so long ago the TSX was threatening to get through 18,000 for the first time. Not so much right now. Stay tuned. Past Picks coming up next. Let's get to those past picks. Andrew was on our show November 4th of last year. Americold Realty Trust, the huge player in cold storage, this one losing altitude.
Yeah, so this is a great company. Went public just over a couple of years ago.
Uh-huh.
In the logistics space, in the cold refrigerated warehouse space, we continue to own this stock. We always believed there would be quarterly volatility. This is really a company you have to think about over a year. If you think about what do? They store, they manage food coming in and coming out. You have peaks and valleys over a year, whether it's stocking up for U.S. Thanksgiving or Christmas. And the analysts are still trying to understand. It's a newly public company. Analysts are still trying to figure out how to model that. They had trouble modeling it in this past quarter. We actually sold some stock going into the quarter, figuring this might happen, and we've been aggressive buyers on this pullback.
Right. So you think it's just kind of a teething trouble as people get their heads around this entity as a public company?
Yeah. It goes back to what do we do at Vision, net asset value investors. If you think about this company, it trades at a 6.5% cap rate. Industrial warehouse, traditional industrial warehouse, trades at a 4% cap rate. That spread is far too wide. At the same time, this is mission critical real estate. It's, if anything, demand for this is only increasing as there is a greater movement to fresh food, whether we eat in restaurants, whether we eat more at home. With population growth, the demographics all work in favor of Americold.
Right, so it's about $32 right now, and it went public, I believe, in 2018. Initially, was trading at only 18, so people are still up from the IPO.
Oh yeah,
price.
We bought on the IPO. We're a large holder of theirs, and we've only been buying along the way.
Okay, Granite REIT. Let's see how this one's done. A 10% return.
Yep. Granite, again, in the industrial space, we like this company a lot. I think very highly of management. Kevin Gorey is the CEO. He successfully built and sold a pure industrial REIT a couple of years ago to Blackstone. Granite's done a great job of diversifying their balance sheet away from their largest tenant, Magna. We like this stock. It's a good hold at this point.
And then finally, BSR REIT, HOM.UN is the symbol, 11% return.
Yeah, BSR is a classic name to own for Vision. It is U.S. apartments traded on the Toronto Stock Exchange, a tremendous arbitrage opportunity where U.S. investors don't come north of the border to buy U.S. apartments. Canadian investors don't really think about what is the value of the U.S. apartments I own. And we see a huge discount to net asset value here, and we think there's a lot of upside to the stock.
Where are their apartments? Are they localized in a region?
So the U.S. Sun Belt. So predominantly in Texas, Houston, Austin, Dallas. They're in Little Rock, Arkansas, and Oklahoma City.
Right. And of course, I guess in past decades, we've seen huge migration to the Sun Belt.
Absolutely. Yeah. And you can see you see it now. I mean, you're seeing massive exodus from the high tax states to the low cost states. There's greater job growth in the city of Dallas and the whole country of Canada. That's the reality. Wow. And at the same time, the rents are affordable. BSR focuses on that middle market rent, $1,000 rents to give context. And we think that's very recession resilient. If you are wondering what inning you're in this cycle, or if you have concerns about what the virus is doing to the economy, we think this is the type of sector you want to be in, residential, recession resilient.
Right. I don't think you'll ever catch me moving to a hot climate. I find it wears me out. Yeah. Anyway, I'm one of those people. Andrew Moffs, Senior Vice President and Portfolio Manager at Vision Capital. He'll take your calls, emails, and tweets on real estate stocks and REITs. 1-855-326-6266. Got Paul calling from North Vancouver. Go ahead, please.
Hi.
Hi there.
I want to talk about RioCan. I know that they're very heavy into shopping centers. Seems like they're starting to migrate away and get more into renting apartments and stuff. But I'm just kind of wondering how you feel about them and whether they're a good buy at this point.
Right. So you're not crazy about malls these days.
Correct. So, yeah, so RioCan, their traditional shopping center format, doesn't excite us at Vision. But what does is their development pipeline, as your caller alluded to. They're doing a very good job of building out what will probably be one of the best apartment for rent portfolios across Canada when it's fully built. But the reality is, when fully done, it might be 10% of their enterprise. The rest will still be retail that every day there's another bankruptcy, whether it's a Pier 1, Art Van Furniture, we're hearing in the U.S. today, Payless, et cetera. They're going to have some struggles. So they do have 3% NOI growth forecasted for this year. Might be a stretch. Mm-hmm. At the same time, it's a solid company, very safe dividend. It's certainly not in a favored asset class of ours. It's definitely a good hold for someone who has it today.
Oh, okay. Now we have Jeff calling from Ottawa. Go ahead, please.
Thanks for taking my call.
Pleasure.
I was going to ask Andrew about Brookfield Property Partners, especially the dividend that's approaching 8%, if it's safe or not. Thank you very much.
Thanks a lot.
So Brookfield Property Partners is managed by Brookfield Asset Management. Brookfield Property Partners, about 80% of it, 85% of the properties is a split between trophy office buildings and Class A, Class B malls in the U.S. That mall sector is very, very challenged. We talked about that with Simon. And as a result, this stock trades at a very wide discount to net asset value. It's enticing. At the same time, we think you're far better off owning the manager of Brookfield Asset Management. I talk a lot about net asset value. So in this case, if Brookfield today, I mean, you're showing the Canadian version, but in the US dollar version, if it's trading in the teens, net asset value might be in the high 20s. That seems pretty interesting, 35, 40% discount to net asset value. Well, I can buy trophy office buildings through publicly traded comps in the U.S., like SL Green. And I can buy Simon Property Group, also trading at 30% discounts to NAVs. While those companies are internally managed, BPY is externally managed. And so I'd rather own Brookfield Asset Management that gets all the fees from the company, and its net asset value is growing 15% a year, while these other companies seem to be more in a treadmill of, I wouldn't quite call them a value trap, but their net asset value is simply not growing.
Mm-hmm. So you would, if you were to invest in the Brookfield Empire, the parent companies would be the one that attracted you?
Yeah, I'd sell BPY and buy BAM.
Okay. We have Wayne standing by in Toronto. Go ahead, please.
Would you please comment on Plaza Retail REIT, PLZ, on the TSX?
So PLZ, small cap shopping center operator focused in Ontario and Quebec, really strong management, sharpshooter CEO that runs this company, owns more neighborhood shopping centers, which is a grocery anchored, which is probably the more defensive place to be in shopping centers. So if you had to own something in retail, you could look at this one. It has a pretty high dividend rate, distribution rate. I'd hold it.
Okay. Roger in Surrey, BC, wants to ask about a stock that you have mentioned already. Go ahead, Roger.
Sorry, Andy, I didn't realize that you'd already commented on it. But yeah, I'd like your comments, if I could, please, on WVT, Industrial Real Estate Trust. Thank you.
Not at all. No, it was just a passing reference. So WPT, what's your take on this one?
So again, I when I talked about BSR REIT, I said, Vision, we like names that there seems to be a bit of a mismatch. And in this case, the mismatch is it's U.S. assets trading on the TSX. In this case, it's industrial warehouse assets that we like that sector. WPT has struggled as a stock to keep up with its peers, its publicly traded peers. We think they might have turned the corner here. They've made they announced and funded a very interesting transaction where they've broadened the markets that they invest in the U.S. They have some very strong institutional partners as well. And it's very tough in this world to find a portfolio of industrial warehouse trading at a 6 cap. Is pretty attractive when, again, 4-4.5% cap rates is the norm.
Oh, okay. So this one would attract you?
Yeah, this is
okay.
Okay.
Roger, thanks for that question. Josephine in Kingston, Ontario, fire ahead, please.
Yes, I'm interested in knowing whether or not Boardwalk is something to hold. I've had it for a number of years, and I wonder what the future looks like for it in this category.
Okay, the apartment giant.
Yeah, so Boardwalk is a stock that we own. It's a buy. This is the value stock in Canadian apartments. So what does that mean? It trades at a discount to net asset value. It has been challenged because it has a focus in Western Canada and Alberta, where concessions had been running very high, meaning the amount of free rent you have to entice a resident to move into your apartment. As they burn off, we estimate as they burn off every 2 weeks of free rent, earnings go up anywhere from 4 to 8%. That's exciting. So you have the ability not only to buy a stock that trades below net asset value, as these concessions burn off, and as we've seen the Alberta economy stabilize, as we've seen net migration into the province, as I mentioned before, you know, you've got 350,000 people moving to this country, you have 750,000 foreign students all renting this type of apartment class, we think that's very good for Boardwalk. It comes with risk. The Alberta economy has bottomed, but there's question marks now with oil coming off. But we think, again, this is the value stock to own.
Okay. We have an email from Gord in Milton, Ontario. Gord wants to know about automotive properties REITs. What are Andrew's thoughts?
So APR, as described, invests in car dealerships in the automotive sector. It is a triple net lease company, meaning they have very long-term leases. So in theory, very safe for a rent profile that comes from their tenants. The risk I'd highlight here is that when you invest in net lease, your goal is to invest in something with a diversified income stream, meaning you have multiple credits that you are underwriting. In this case, it's primarily coming from one. It's the Del Lowry Group, which is a very strong automotive dealership across owner across Canada. At the same time, they're private. We don't have access to their financials. I can't comment on their creditworthiness. So at the moment, it seems safe. Has a high dividend yield, but for us, is the type of name we'd avoid. It trades at a premium to net asset value.
Okay, so sorry, their essential holding is in this private auto dealership group. Is that what you said?
So an auto dealership group that operates and sells cars.
Sure. Yes.
This REIT owns the actual real estate.
Oh, I see.
And leases it to that group. Oh. That group pays the rent, but I can't underwrite that group because they're not public and they don't provide the financials.
Okay, we're going to be back with Andrew Moffs, Senior VP and Portfolio Manager at Vision Capital, and he'll take your calls, emails, and tweets on real estate equities and REITs. 1-855-326-6266. We have an email from David. David wants to know about H&R REIT. What's your view, especially in a potential recession?
So H&R REIT is a diversified REIT. It owns malls across Canada. It owns office buildings with long-term leases, with a couple in the United States. It has a very good apartment business in the U.S. That we like a lot, and it owns industrial warehouse. This company has struggled. It has great management. However, their capital allocation has been a cause for concern for the stock. And what does that mean? So today, they own what was formerly, they own the Bow, which was occupied formerly by Encana in Calgary. So that's been a big question mark and overhang on the stock. As well as, as I mentioned, they own Primaris, this mall portfolio across Canada, which is a very tough sector to be in. Once they figure out what to do with those two assets, I think the stock can lift, but until that point, it seems to be stalled in this range.
So, sorry, they have this retail arm, you said Primaris?
Primaris, yes.
Okay, and then what was the other asset you think they have to figure out what to do with?
The Bow building in Calgary.
The giant building.
Yeah. Great asset, great building, but their largest tenant has moved south of the border. And
the former Encana.
Exactly. Yeah. I mean, it's a long-term lease. They still pay the rent, but it will need to be released at some point.
Okay, and the yield now on H&R, 6.7%. So people are demanding a big yield there. Natalie in Toronto, go ahead, please.
Thank you so much for taking my call.
Pleasure.
I'd like to have the outlook on Riemann Hospitality. I know nothing about it. I understand it has a fantastic yield, and it's in the U.S. I'd like to know if it's worthwhile investing in it for the long term, and is the dividend safe, and can I sleep well at night and forget about it? So thank you so much for giving me your opinion.
Absolutely.
Thank you.
It's difficult to buy a hotel stock, put it away, and forget about it. I'd caution on doing that. And for example, this stock, Riemann Hospitality, RHP, is the ticker on the New York Stock Exchange. If there is a stock to own in the hotel space, this is one. We actually used to own it, successfully sold it. Why did we own it? Because they own very large convention hotels, five, six of them across the U.S. They operate under the Gaylord brand. And so these are basically massive football field hotels where they have business on the books for the next several years, massive group business. but
Look at the sell-off today. I guess people are worried about the convention business. Sorry.
You know, just give you a great example. A publicly traded peer, Diamond Rock Hospitality, they just announced today, they'd given guidance 2 weeks ago where they said, you know, this year we've, so far with the coronavirus, we've only lost $1 million of group business. Fast forward 2 weeks, they had to put out a press release today saying we're taking guidance off the table because in the past 2 weeks we've left $10 million of group business on the books for this year. That's the type of the business you depend on in the hotels.
Yeah.
As opposed to the 24-hour before independent business traveler or leisure traveler.
This is a time to be booking hotel rooms, I suppose.
Yeah, you should load up.
Get
your reservations in.
Yeah. And I guess the dilemma is, do you book a cruise for this fall? You can probably get great prices if you're willing to take the risk.
Yeah. Just have insurance policy on that, yeah.
Oh, yeah, travel cancellation insurance. Yeah. Good plan. We've got Rama calling from Toronto. Go ahead, please.
Hello, Andrew. This is Rama from Toronto.
Thanks for calling. What's your question, please?
Oh, hi, this is Ryan from Toronto. Can you hear me okay?
Okay, I think we've got Ryan now. What's your question, please?
All right, I wanted to ask about Slate Office REIT, the discounts to tangible book value, and if you think the dividend is sustainable or potentially can be increased. Thank you for taking the call.
Thanks very much.
So this is a REIT focused on the office sector. We're not bulls on the office sector. We all use office space differently today, meaning there's a big densification effort. If, you know, 20 years ago, you'd build a building to 250 square feet per worker. Today, you're cramming in enough workers that it's 150 square feet per worker.
Wow.
So the secular, I talked about secular changes. This is one in the office space that we're not keen on.
This is the office space. The open office cramming the workers in?
Yeah, but even lawyers today, you know, you don't have a law library. So if a law firm is going to renew, they're going to stay in place but take less space.
Sure.
If you work at Deloitte and Touche, you're an accountant, there's no offices for partners anymore. Every day you're coming in getting a new office desk. And then the next day you'll get another desk.
Even if you're a top person.
So you can't put a picture on your desk anymore.
Well, that's interesting. Yeah.
So anyway, getting back to Slate, they operate in the office space. We're not bulls on it. I think they've simply been growing in some of the submarkets we're not very keen on. If you're going to focus on office, you want to be in downtown Toronto. They are not in downtown Toronto. Why downtown Toronto? You have a demand and supply mismatch currently. The markets they are in don't have that. It's typically more of a tenant market than a landlord market.
Right. And so, sorry, what is Slate's focus then these days? What kind of properties? It is office property, even though it's called Slate Retail REIT.
Oh, I thought you were talking about Slate Office REIT.
Oh, I'm very sorry. I managed to confuse everybody. Okay, so it was Slate Office, and I think we did put up Slate Retail. So your comments were on Slate Office.
Correct.
And just maybe we can put that one up. I'm sorry, I probably caused the confusion there. Slate Office. The symbol on that one is SOT.UN, okay? And so just to reiterate, you're not crazy about the outlook on that one?
Yeah, secondary office with a, you know, 37% of its buildings are in Atlantic Canada. We're not very keen on their holdings.
Okay, no problem. Thanks very much. Sorry for the any confusion there. Okay, so let's check in on the markets. The Dow, not much joy on that front. Now down almost 1,000 points. Look at that, 3.5%. Not a pretty picture for the Dow Jones. Let's have a quick look at Toronto and see how that one is doing. A decline of 1.6% or so on Toronto. And let's have a look at our friend the S&P. So this is a pretty ominous day for the markets. I'm just trying to check whether the Dow is still up from its Tuesday close after that big rally. The Dow is still up from Friday and Thursday at around it's around 26,100 right now, but it is down on from Wednesday of last week. So quite. Yeah, there's the week for the Dow Jones, now down 2%. Let me see if I can call up the score for the year so far for the markets. The unknown seems to be worrying people here, just how far-reaching will the effects of this virus be. I'm now showing in local currency terms, the S&P 500 down almost 6% this year, now down 5.7%. In 2020, and there is gold. gold. There's an intraday. Maybe we can put up a 1 year for gold or even a 10 year, because we are not far off 7 year highs for gold. And let's have a look at a 10 year. Remember back in 2011, gold got to just briefly north of 1,900 US. And look at that, close to multi-year highs for gold. So a worrying market right now. I think we have Rama in Toronto. Go ahead, Rama, please.
Hello, Andrew. This is Rama from Toronto.
Thank you.
I'm a long-time listener and a first-time caller.
Oh, great. Thanks.
I would like to ask your guest to comment on the Interrent Real Estate, that is IIP.UM. It seems to be doing well. It has a P/E ratio of 6.55 and pays a dividend of 1.6.
Okay.
And I understand they also have properties in Toronto, Montreal, Ottawa. And I would like to comment, ask your guest to comment on this. And it seems to be doing very well. I bought it a couple of years ago. It seems to be doing very well.
Okay, thanks very much. Okay, yeah. Interrent REIT.
A company we really like, very strong management. These guys are the value add operators in the apartment space, meaning they buy buildings, they fix them up, and as a result, they're able to increase rents, particularly in rent controlled environments, get above guideline increases on the rents. And hence, I mean, the stock's rebounded, has responded very well to this program, multi-year, year after year, and we see tremendous net asset value growth in this company, 25% mark-to-market in rents. At the same time, at this point, it's now around $19. It has definitely gone through its net asset value and is not cheap, but it has a lot of growth. So if you've owned this, you'll likely continue to hold it, maybe sell a little into some of the strength, look for pullbacks to buy it. We think, as I said, very highly of management.
Okay, Rama, thanks very much indeed for that question. Menno in Winnipeg, go ahead, please.
Good morning. I'd like your guest to comment on a couple of small REITs, BTV and PRV, relative to their sustainability in terms of the dividend.
BTV.
So BTV is Quebec-focused small cap REIT. I think over time you'll find it'll be challenging for them to grow their net operating income. Even though the Quebec economy is doing very well, I don't know if their portfolio enjoys the same success in terms of that growth. And hence, their high distribution yield is probably pretty tight in terms of coverage. And it's just a name we haven't traditionally owned at Vision.
Okay, no problem. We're going to take a break. We're going to have Andrew's top picks next. You're watching Market Call. Top pick number one, you are sticking with BSR REIT.
Yeah, so a theme for your viewers, I think, with all three of our picks will be you want to have stocks that are recession resilient, but still have growth, and BSR fits firmly in that camp. U.S. Sunbelt Apartments listed on the TSX, and I'll make it very simple. We talked about the private market. We saw a very large transaction occur, a portfolio called Aragon sold to the Harbor Group. Two-thirds of that portfolio overlapped in BSR's markets. Same vintage, same type of assets. Mm-hmm. It traded at a 4.6 cap rate. If I put a 5% cap rate on BSR, that's an $18 stock, and it's a $13 stock today. So we see a big discount to NAV and a lot of growth in this company.
And a cap rate, essentially the equivalent of a yield on a real estate asset. Tricon Capital, another player in U.S. residential.
Another player in U.S. residential and another player in this middle market strategy that BSR follows. Tricon, the exact same. About 70% of Tricon's portfolio is in the single family for rent industry. They buy homes, single family homes in the United States, and rent them out. We love this business. Tricon's been at the forefront. They're a top five operator in the U.S. And you hear that, and you hear their metrics, their same-store NOI metrics, high single-digit, 10% NOI growth rate in some cases, yet far greater than its U.S. peers, yet it trades at an 18% discount to NAV, meanwhile its peers in the U.S. trade at a premium. The other 30% of their business, roughly, most of that is in U.S. apartments, just like BSR REIT. They have a portfolio that they bought from Starlight in U.S. apartments. And then they also have a housing land development business. Very, very strong management, great board. We think it's cheap.
And then finally, Storage Vault. They're up to about 201 facilities now across Canada.
Yeah, so the U.S. self-storage sector certainly has come of age in the past 20 years since in the time I've been following REITs. Storage vaults and here in Canada, operating here in Canada, Canada is certainly many years behind the U.S. and definitely many years behind in terms of consolidating the industry. Storage vault is by far the sector leader, yet they probably only own 7% of the sector. Here you have a company trading just below net asset value, but that net asset value is growing every year. You know, same store NOI is probably going to be 7% for this company. And yet they still have a great external growth story. You talk about recession resilience. People need to store their stuff, and people have a lot of stuff. And as there's a greater consumer awareness, you know, we estimate, you know, there's 2 to 3 square feet per capita of self-storage in this country. In the U.S., we estimate 8 to 9 square feet per square feet per capita. So there's a big penetration story that can happen here.
What we all need to do, including me, is just throw that stuff away. Just get rid of it.
Give it to a self-storage facility, preferably a storage vault one, and we'll be happy.
Yeah, yeah. Honestly, you can't take it with you. What do they call it? Swedish death cleaning. They'll start cleaning out their stuff before they die. Anyway, I'm getting morbid now. Speaking of which, let's have a look at the markets. We have seen U.S. stocks under significant pressure. The Dow Jones, a decline now of about 3.5%. The Nasdaq, almost 3%. TSX holding up a little bit better, but the markets now into negative territory for the year pretty decisively. We saw earlier the S&P now down around 6% for the year, Toronto down 3%. Thanks very much, Andrew.
Thanks for having me on.
We are out of time on Market Call. Tune in tomorrow.